Well, good afternoon, and thank you for joining us on the Don and Gino Real Estate and Finance Show. Today, substituting for Don Gettling is Steve Korn. How you doing, buddy?
Awesome, buddy. Thanks for having me in.
And our friend Don Gettling is having a little fun right now, right?
Yeah, much deserved, I might add, but, you know, it still doesn't mean we're going to bag on him today. So.
Oh, yeah. He knows what the drill is.
Oh, for sure.
When he's away, you know, we got to beat him up pretty good. And also joining us, a good friend, is Lou Esbin from Esbin Law. How you doing?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me.
Excellent, excellent. And he's also known as the debt doctor.
The debt doctor.
Yeah, in the house. Good stuff, good stuff. Well, today is no different than any other Thursday that Don and I are here. We're going to discuss your personal and financial wellness, brought to you by Cherry Creek Mortgage, which we have been working really hard at Cherry Creek Mortgage the last few days. Thank you for going out and buying homes. People are listening, and it is busy out there.
I can attest to that, too. We're seeing lots of activity in the marketplace locally, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. We'll talk a little bit more about that. And with Lou, we'll talk a little bit more about business today, Lou.
Right.
We want to get into how the business world is going and get your opinion on whether this recovery has some feet under it or not. So I actually feel it does. So let's get into that a little bit.
Okay.
I want to start with Cyprus, though, first. I want to talk a little bit about Cyprus and this Europe still lingering.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So how do you guys feel about that? Would it be okay if maybe our government didn't do their job and they said, well, we're just going to keep some of your deposits? Is that all right?
I think we have some political unrest about that going on in our free country.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's a different situation over there than we have here. I don't know if they have the same regulatory framework that we have.
Well, they absolutely don't, and that's why they're in that situation. And one of the things that I wanted to tie that to, being from Argentina, I've seen a similar structure before where when the Argentine government collapsed in the year 2000, sure enough, that's what happened. They ended up having to resort to the depositors' monies that were deposited in the banking system, and that brings total collapse to the entire country. So,
well, the interesting thing about Cyprus, it seems like a lot of the deposits are actually of former Eastern Bloc, Eastern European countries and depositors. So it's an interesting issue and dynamic that's going on there between whose money it actually is. And it's not really Cypriot money. It's a lot of Russian money and those countries of Eastern Europe.
Well, and what I did not know that, Lou, so thank you for that insight. And the thing that I found interesting was that the problem was caused by Greek debt. So Greece continues to resurface in the European economy, causing problems. And, you know, for a small little island, beautiful but small, been causing a lot of problems over the last couple of years.
Yeah, I think it's going to continue to ripple. We'll have to see what kind of impact it's going to have on our economy.
Yeah.
If any.
Yeah, well, I was thinking, you know, as we speculate what it could be, we're pretty resilient here in the United States. I mean, God bless everything that we do, but I think, you know, we've been dodging some pretty big bullets from the East and the Europe money problems you've been having so far. So we've been,
I think you have to separate out, and this will probably get into what we're going to talk about. I think you have to separate out the organized exchanges, let's call them that exist around the world through which commodities and stocks and bonds are traded from the actual economy that we all exist in. And I think there's a difference between the two. I mean, will the issues in Greece and Cyprus and Spain and Italy have an impact upon, you know, our economy, so to speak? Maybe not. Will it have an impact upon our markets? That's to be seen.
Well, I think that's actually a great point, Lou. And what we've seen is there's a knee-jerk reaction to the news. But then after the knee-jerk reaction and the news is processed, every single time, whatever abrupt change happened in the market has been erased by our standard economy, and people say, well, wait a second, how, they take a minute to think about it and say, well, how is that going to affect Caterpillar? How is that going to affect Microsoft? No, it's not going to have any impact. Keep buying stocks.
Well, I'm more concerned about the Treasury's continuing its QE.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've talked about that.
Yeah.
You know, that, you know, QE1, QE2, QE3.
QE infinity.
You know, what happens when the music stops?
Yeah.
Just like it did in 2008.
Well, let's actually discuss that. And you're listening to the Don and Gino Real Estate and Finance Show, and joining me is Lou Esbin and Steve Korn, and we're discussing a little bit of worldwide economy, but also some local economy. And right now, we're getting it into QE infinity, as I call it. The Fed statement yesterday actually changed. They actually changed their tune. They now are no longer giving the definitive purchase price of how many mortgage-backed securities they're going to purchase every week. Now they said they put the dimmer switch on it, and they said they would like to adjust as necessary.
Oh, well, that's good.
Yeah. So I think that Steve and I were discussing a little earlier that I think that's Big Ben, and that's Ben Bernanke. I like to call him Big Ben, saying, okay, I'm not going to tell you guys what I'm going to do anymore. I'm going to just do what I think is necessary. And I think that's the first step in saying, if the economy continues in the direction it's going, I'm going to wean us off the bottle.
Well, then again, it goes to the point that there's a difference between the markets and the economy. And QE has been propping up the markets.
And significantly at that. I mean, it's been propping up all stock markets, pretty much all the exchanges, S&P, NASDAQ, and the Dow have benefited from it, as well as mortgage-backed securities and bonds. So all asset classes have benefited from QE. And so how do we remix the two, the economy and the markets? Because now we need a economy-driven market and not a stimulus-driven
market.
Well,
and you know, there's historical precedent to the Fed and the Treasury, you know, mixing into the markets and the economy and then what the long-term effect is. And, you know, those of you who would remember, you know, you had inflation that came out of Vietnam and the guns and butter policies of Johnson. And so that Carter and Nixon had, you know, inflation, and Volcker tightened up on inflation and increased interest rates to 17-18%. I mean, I remember our first home we paid 16.5% interest, and the markets got accustomed to very high interest rates. And so how is the Fed going to wean the market off of yet another type of stimulant that seems to become, you know, every decade or so they come up with another stimulant to keep the market on its, you know, going? What's going to be the next stimulant when they take away this stimulant?
Well, I think the overall consumer economics is going to drive that too. But I don't know, from a local standpoint, looking at our economy, I don't see very many things suffering. People are spending lots of money. You go out to restaurants, they're packed. Go to malls, they're busy. You go to, you know, you go to anywhere where consumers are going to spend money, and they're out there spending money. So I'm not sure where the stimulant could be withdrawn from that won't impact the entire economy.
Right. I'm talking about the stimulant on organized markets versus the economy, and I agree with you. I think that people are out there and they feel more confident, which is the intent of stimulating the organized markets, is to create that consumer confidence. And I think there is more confidence. I'm seeing more clients who are starting business. We're starting to see a pickup in that. But I think what is a residual effect of this last economy is people are being very concerned about getting more credit. And I've always preached that if it's not in your pocket, you shouldn't be spending it. And I think a lot of people are adhering to that philosophy.
Sure.
And I think that's a good thing for the local economy.
It's a big trend for that cash spending business.
It sure is.
Yeah, it's good. It's good to see too.
Oh, that's actually fantastic. I actually want to dive really deep on that, because I know you have some rules on how you're supposed to decide whether it's a good thing to purchase something or not. And I think those rules are imperative going forward to be able to make a good decision. When we come back to the Don and Gino Real Estate and Finance Show every Thursday from 12 to 2, the first hour with the finance hour, and the second hour is the real estate hour. And today, hosting with me is Steve Korn, as a stand-in for Don Getling. Don, I hope you're having fun, buddy, and we'll be right back.
Bye-bye.